Health authorities are treating dozens of pneumonia cases of unknown cause in Wuhan, China.
Health officials say a new coronavirus is behind the pneumonia outbreak in Wuhan.
Canada has confirmed its first presumptive case of coronavirus in Toronto.
Today, the World Health Organization has declared COVID-19 a pandemic.
Health services really haven't been set up with Indigenous people in mind. At a time like a pandemic, like COVID, we see, unfortunately, these structural inequities emerge in real ways.
So all the murals you see back here is a series of murals our guys did maybe 3-4 years ago. And basically it's their interpretations and depictions of the four sacred medicines that are very common for Indigenous people all over Turtle Island. So because COVID now is a thing and a reality for us, we put a lot of protocols in place with our shelters. We've really changed the way we do things for the reasons of safety and to prevent the spread of COVID getting into our shelters and having another outbreak. Closing was not an option. It never was even entered my mind at all. When we had those outbreaks, I wasted a day and a half seeking help to deal with the situation. And I couldn't find any. There was no protocols. I reached out to public health and they were sort of ill-prepared, I think, for this pandemic due to various funding cuts and so on that they had experienced prior to the pandemic. I couldn't find any sound advice. So finally, I quit looking for help where there was none. And we just started dealing with it ourselves. We communicated to our staff and didn't keep anything secret. We called the incoming shifts in the evening and asked them, hey, are you gonna come in for your shift? You know, we had an outbreak in here and we just wanna know. If you're not planning to come in, please let us know so we can make sure that we have the staffing covered. We in communicating to all our staff, 20% of our staff asked for a layoff. We gave them that layoff, no questions, no judgment. We knew people were nervous and a little scared. We made sure that safety was a number one priority for our staff and our residents. We did educational workshops for the residents on safe hand washing techniques and made sure that high touch surface areas were cleaned frequently. I believe we did all the right things. So then I started talking to Dr. Janet Smiley and she was concerned and offered help in any way she could.
I felt an obligation to reach out to all of the First Nations, Inuit, and Métis communities and organizations that I had been working with as the director of the Well-Living House Research Program. I called Steve to find out what was going on with that outbreak. He told me what he'd done, and he did a better job than I would have been able to do. But again, not surprised, because the most common error is to underestimate the capacity that we have in our community organizations. I sent out an email to all of the First Nations, Inuit, and Métis and Indigenous organizations I work with here in Toronto, in the province of Ontario, across the country, and I said, look, I do have some training in public health, some couple decades of health service experience. What can I do to help?
At first, I believe we had everything dealt with, and I was more concerned about our staff and making sure they feel safe coming to work. So I asked Dr. Janet and Dr. Suzanne Shush, the two Indigenous doctors that we work with, to if they feel we did all the right things, to write a letter to reflect that. So they wrote a really nice letter giving our staff credit for managing the outbreak very well, that we stopped it dead in its tracks. And I think that was very helpful. And that's what started our working relationship.
We started a network of Indigenous service providers, doctors, nurses, midwives, and Indigenous health agencies. And we just started meeting every week or two. And Steve would come on to these meetings and he'd say, we need our own testing site.
One of our managers at NAMIRA said, hey, Steve, we have that vacant building next door. That would be great if we could offer it up as a testing center for the community. So, I started talking to Dr. Smiley, and then we formed our leadership group and started working with seventh generation midwives. And that's how the early beginnings of Auduzhe, Mino, Nesewinong testing center started, which in Ojibwe means the place of healthy breathing.
That has been a theme of the pandemic to from day one until now, is that there's a lot of government involvement telling us what to do. And that for many Indigenous people can be very familiar in a negative way.
All of the different kind of institutions that have mobilized around COVID are really around, the shelter systems suddenly become closed down. Public health is suddenly putting out all these restrictions. There's a lot more policing out on the streets. And all of these different institutions have been institutions that have historically, and even up until present day, really not had a good relationship with Indigenous people. So when you're trying to enact something like, let's just say infection control, so something like wearing masks or washing your hands or putting those things into place are experienced as social control, especially for Indigenous people. So the institutions that are responding to the pandemic are the same institutions that have historically played a role in oppressing Indigenous people. So it's hard to have trust in those kinds of institutions. We wanted to create a space where people would feel comfortable coming earlier rather than later. It's unusual when an Indigenous person comes out of a healthcare experience, and it's a good one. The very first thing that we start with is that healthcare is not necessarily a safe place or somewhere where the first place that you would think of going if you're feeling ill or if you're worried.
With this pandemic, one thing that's really come out in the open was a lot of racism within healthcare that Indigenous people face on a fairly regular basis. You know, there's been countless reports that I've seen about Indigenous people and negative experiences with our healthcare system.
Really understanding like the history of surveillance of Indigenous people, the history of trauma that we've experienced and structural oppression from the state that our parents and our grandparents went through, and just being very conscious of that.
We wanted to create a space where people would feel comfortable bringing their families or themselves or being able to access care in a dignified way for testing. So we came together to figure out how to do that.
When COVID hits in a city, the first thing that we saw here in Toronto in the Indigenous community was gaps in urgent access to health and social resources.
This pandemic has really exacerbated some already existing inequalities that we experience in the Indigenous community.
90% of the First Nations, Inuit, and Métis community here in Toronto is living below the poverty line. They're poor, so there's a huge need for food banks. Right, so in the first couple of weeks of the lockdown in March, there was babies that didn't have food, elders that were shut in.
I've seen issues around transportation, issues around accessing medical care and culturally relevant medical care.
No safe place for people to self-isolate.
Lots of mental health and emotional wellness being exacerbated by the pandemic.
So you gotta respond to those emergent health and social needs. But then we also wanna provide access to testing, right? And then we also wanna provide access to care, COVID care for those people that have COVID. And of course, then if unfortunately they get hospitalized, we wanna support them in the hospital, but also regular health care. So we said, okay, how can we wrap that all together? So we came up with a model addressing those gaps, but also for the testing site. And by that point, I'd also been able to speak and look at different models. So there's an NGO, Partners in Health, that had done a lot of work already with the Navajo Nation. We were connected to them and they were helping us. And they said the best way to respond to COVID-19 for Native American communities, First Nations, Inuit and Métis, and other communities experiencing social exclusion is actually to have integrated services.
Having like that comprehensive wraparound support was a huge part of it.
When somebody who comes to the center and who tests positive or who at risk of being exposed to somebody who was positive, we help support them to make sure that they have support that they need.
Say one of the major needs that came up from the beginning, it was first of all, like getting people to the site. So that was a part of the model from the very beginning.
We had some folks who were like, my son is sick, but I actually have 5 other kids at home and I can't drive across town to be able to come and get tested. And so we started to say, okay, so we need to find a way to be able to support families like this or households like this. And you always offer options, right? Like, part of what we're doing is that we're not the only option. We're happy to, like, you know, we just want people to get tested and we want people to be well. And so even providing other options like, oh, well, you're living in this area. Why don't we make an appointment here since it's really right down the road from you? If that's if you don't have transportation, that's where you'd rather go.
Some folks who come to this site do not have a place to isolate. That may be because they don't have a place to live at the moment, or it could be because they live in a household where there's not a space that they can isolate by themselves. So there, in that instance, we will get one of the clinicians would do a referral to an isolation hotel so that the community member can actually safely isolate there. For some community members, isolating means that they aren't able to, like, grocery shop, for example. So then we reach out to our community members' partners to be able to provide the family a food box so that they could actually isolate in a more safe way without actually going into the public. We also sometimes have community members who want to speak to an elder. So then it would be one of my roles is to reaching out to the community for an elder, the community member to communicate with. So those are some type of the services that we offer.
There was a lot of really important cultural awareness and sensitivity training that came with our model. Everybody's connected in our communities. So when we're working with somebody who might have COVID or be at risk of having COVID, knowing that, like, you might be related to them, you might know somebody, you might know their family, you might know their workplace. So really holding sacred their confidentiality, holding people's autonomy very sacred, that we're not forcing anyone to do anything, that we want people to know all of their rights, all of their, what the process is gonna look like, and not ever have them feel like they're coerced through it.
It's one thing to look at it on a piece of paper and say, okay, I need to do these things, it's a bit of a checklist, but then how do I apply this checklist when I'm actually living, like, with my mother and my children, and I only have one bathroom, and how do we keep it clean between, and how do I self-isolate in this small space? So it's about being able to take those public health, the public health guidance, and being able to apply it in real time. And I think that that's been a really big success of the program.
As we all are aware, we can go anywhere in the city to get a COVID test. But I think that when we come to a space that where it really honors and respects your culture, it's a little bit, it's a little different. I think kind of as being the outreach worker, people are not just coming here for their tests.
A space where Indigenous folks would be able to get their questions answered, would be able to actually access care in a way that left them feeling good and feeling like they had received dignified care when they otherwise would be avoidant. and that recognized, like, you know, that where it was, we wanted to create a very Indigenous space.
Providing that emotional, mental support throughout the testing process, and meeting those cultural needs, which are found in our medicines, in our Indigenous values, in our seven grandfather teachings, those cultural teachings and ethics that we carry as a community, was a huge part of it.
We also smudge the place frequently throughout the day. So at any given time, if you walk in, you're gonna smell sage. It's gonna kind of be more of a inviting and warm for folks versus it being more of like a hospital and white walls and whatnot. We do also have some artwork and those things that kind of make it a little bit more safer and a little bit more calming for our Indigenous community.
You know, this is really a beautiful response in a warm, friendly, inviting environment for Indigenous people to come where they don't have to worry about dealing with discrimination or racism.
The Center for Wise Practices over at Women's College Hospital really helped us out with this Auduzhe clinic. They were critical to helping us feel confident that we had what is called IPAC, or infection prevention and control, done, which is important because we wanted people to come to the clinic to get tested for COVID but not get COVID when they came here. But one of the things that you need to do to maintain IPAC is to have flow. We were really lucky with this beautiful building. It's like an older building in Toronto that had already been retrofitted for health, so there's a wheelchair ramp. If we think about the clinic and the flow kind of as ceremony then, versus thinking about us being herded, right, as non-humans, right, then we can get into that. We're good at movement and flow and figuring out how to make our way along a trail in a graceful manner, or dance, or how to do a grand entry. It's interesting because we go one way for the testing, and then on our vaccine days, we actually flow the other way.
We also offer infection prevention and control training for any new staff. There's a lot of training involved, particularly, you know, when we operate a clinic, staff have to wear full protective gear, you know, the gowns, the mask, the visor, everything. So there's even training on how to properly put that equipment on in a safe manner. You know, we had heard in the media there was a number of concerns with public health and their ability to contact trace in a timely manner. And when we set this up, we thought, well, let's do our own contact tracing.
We really looked to the Navajo community in the South, who was doing amazing work in their communities around contact tracing. So what we did was speak with the Navajo and really kind of get quite a bit of teaching from them around how they were approaching their case investigation and contact tracing. And so we wanted to be able to set up a system that would work within the Indigenous communities. Even just thinking about all of those contact tracing questions from an Indigenous point of view and speaking with them about how they did it, we were able to take that and then adapt it to the urban Indigenous experience here in Toronto.
The difference with the model that was created through the Auduzhe site. So we have a very specific team of contact tracers and contact investigators who are Indigenous. So that's the first difference, is that you actually have people that are from our communities working with our communities.
And I think that the contact tracing and the case investigation is actually I think it's quite astounding and very well done, because it really combines both the public health contact tracing and the community outreach, which is just a part of the way that we work as Indigenous people, is to take care of each other, right? Like, really take care of those kinship relationships and recognize that not everybody in the city has them. And so you want to make sure to keep that in your, to include that in your model, because it's meaningful to people. What I would say is that a lot of the way that we work is by using Indigenous kinship system models as a way to guide the work that we're doing in terms of outreach. One of the things that we did was to start a hotline called the Call Anti Hotline, which was a phone line for Indigenous folks to call if they had questions about anything and everything. The beginning of the pandemic, like almost right away, was when we started the hotline, and as a group, we really talked about it and came up with this approach. So having those pathways set up has been really effective. Like, people will actually come where they would refuse to go anywhere else.
Kind of one of the hiccups that we've kind of been experiencing, especially with outreach. Traditionally, what we would do is, without COVID, we would be going to organizations and approaching the EDs, executive directors of the field organizations to help gather the community members to come to our center. However, because of COVID, that's kind of proven to be difficult. So what we've been doing is kind of being very creative and doing special flyers, as well as a lot of online outreach, a lot of emailing, but also doing Facebook Live kind of shows, as well as polls on Facebook. So kind of gets community members interacting. And then, you know, from that, then the word spreads. Tell one person and 10 other people know, and it kind of trickles down. So that's how we've kind of been doing it so far.
My name is Dr. Suzanne Shush, and I'm here with the incredible Vivian Timmons for your COVID-19 vaccination. You can give us a call at Auduzhe, Mino, Nesewinong.
The strengths that we can use to overcome are the strengths we've always used, is to work together in a good way across our relations. We know who we are in cities, and we have extremely strong social networks. So what we were able to do is create We Count COVID, by the people, for the people, collection of health information. One of the things that we also were really fortunate is we had really smart public health people at the very beginning. And they'd been involved in community-based public health responses in Africa during Ebola. They also are really smart at knowing what information do you need to collect in a community during an epidemic of infectious disease like COVID, that doesn't research people to death, but gets the essential bits of information that actually will impact disease spread, so we can learn about that and hopefully mitigate this spread. And then how can we actually do a little bit about addressing those gaps in health information that I spoke about in a way that actually advances First Nations, Inuit, and Métis data sovereignty? Nothing about us without us. So that's how we came up with the We Count COVID research program. So with respect to the Our Health Counts, which is a community partnered approach to building health information, comprehensive health assessment information for First Nations, Inuit, and Métis living in urban and related homelands. And we've been able to do that in partnership with 6 urban First Nations, Inuit, and Métis communities. We were able to build on the platform of Our Health Counts and then customize it for COVID. We were able to move pretty quickly, just building on those existing relationships.
So We Count COVID is a research project which basically counts Indigenous people who have tested positive for COVID, because there's a lack of reliable data when it comes to Indigenous people and their experiences with COVID. That data, we never want any of our research or data to cause any harm to any community members. We know with Indigenous people in Canada, we have a long history of being involved with various research that did some very unethical things to our communities. And a lot of our community members, that's not lost on them. So we always have a responsibility to make sure that this data will never cause harm to people. And both NAMI-RES and Seventh Generation Midwives acts as stewards of the data. We know with that data, it can illustrate various health disparities that maybe the Indigenous community is facing more than other communities within Toronto. And it's really important to gather that Indigenous-specific data, because we know in mainstream healthcare systems, Indigenous people don't always feel safe to self-identify. So this is a safe place for community members to come and self-identify and participate in Indigenous-led and run research.
I often think and like to quote former Grand Chief Phil Fontaine when he says the answers lie in our communities. But I also think about the underlying importance of strong relationships or Wakotawin. So we already have that network of relationships, and it's really important.
I would say what makes this unique is in our Indigenous health approach is that, number one, I think decisions are made by consensus, which is more of an Indigenous governance style. You know, at our leadership table, we have Indigenous people. In the staffing of Auduzhe, we also have Indigenous staff. It truly is for Indigenous by Indigenous.
partnerships and the relationships like within the governing group, so SGMT, Well Living House, and NAMI-RES are really critical to the success. It was about building out a clinical program, relying on relationships and partnerships to be able to make that happen in a good way. We are the ones who are accountable to the community. We're the ones who are working to be able to both support the research to happen and at the same time run a service for the community to actually access.
Everybody holds a piece of the puzzle. Everybody has a purpose. And nobody's perfect.
And I think the thing about COVID, it has reminded us, here in Ontario especially, the haves and have-nots, right? Because look at how many First Nations still do not have access to clean water. And what is one of the things they say to help minimize the spread of COVID? Wear a mask, wash your hands, sanitize, and keep your distance, right? So if one of those pivotal things is not happening in the province for the majority of Indigenous people on reserve, what other options are available?
This is what's really exciting about the Auduzhe program, is I feel like we're actually now creating space and highlighting an Indigenous model of public health. So to me, the things that are most important is we build on our networks and relationships with each other, which are strong here in the city. There's a false assumption that we don't have those things in the city, but we have them. We have relationships with other human beings. We have relationships with land. The other thing that is important is they're rooted in First Nations, Inuit, and Métis culture. And here in the city of Toronto, it's amazing. We found a way, right, to uphold each other as First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people with multiple languages, multiple traditions. Even within one group, I'm Métis Cree on my mom's side, there would be quite a lot of diversity in terms of how people might express that because people have moved around. I think probably in other community, First Nations and Inuit community as well, but we seem to just be able to accept that about each other, hold up, respect, and come together. So that's really special to enrich. So we need to build on those things, our relationships and our culture, but not just what we wear or the ceremonies that we do, culture in terms of natural laws and the values and protocols that accompany those natural laws.
The crowd liked it? Woo-hoo! Well, you got a cheer up there, all right. We've got a wild audience today, don't we?
What I will say is that one of my experiences that I think has contributed to our success and needs to continue in order for us to continue to be successful is our ability to shift and change and react really quickly. So for example, you know, setting up a whole clinical system with labs, with supplies, with staffing, it takes a lot of work. And when you think about it, like the rest of the places in town that are running testing centers, a lot of them have huge infrastructure, right? Like they're hospitals with huge infrastructure, huge staff, and we're doing it in a much smaller scale. So it's a lot of work. And so just when we kind of set up the testing and had it going and working really well, then comes the vaccines. So suddenly it's also being able to pivot and change and react to both the needs of the community and the changing face of the pandemic, right? And so now I think that the vision was really being able just to bring services and provide services that are meaningful, but also are going to have the biggest impact in terms of keeping people well and stopping the spread of COVID. A lot of the success is both just in creating the space, which is a really amazing thing to have created.
They didn't feel intrusive. They didn't feel surveillance-like, which has been my experience when I've gotten tests at other places. Not only was this space about supporting me through the Euro Western medical system, but I was also providing Indigenous sacred medicines to support me, to ground me, to help me to know my status.
I would say that I'm really proud of the work that's done by the outreach team. I think that they really connect with folks in a way that they haven't necessarily experienced before in terms of follow-up.
What makes the job rewarding is when people call or when people leave messages on social media that they come through the site and they're recommending for their community members to come in, not only because it's safe, but also of how they were treated by the clinicians and how their answers were answered in a more in-depth way versus it just being in and out.
We're not like a fast food testing clinic, we're a feast clinic. When we have our vaccine clinics, it's beautiful.
We definitely do take time to, meet the client where they're at.
Lots of postings on Facebook that of people who've had good experiences going to get a test or going to get a vaccine. We've been contacted by family members of people who've come through the site who have said things like, I knew they were coming there and I was just like, they're gonna get kicked out. They're not gonna be able to, they have to go, but they're not gonna be able to get through that. And they came out very happy, and the family members are like, we have never had an experience like this with any sort of medical engagement. And so things like that were just that we know that we're reaching folks.
We're only increasing the wellness of our community when we are able to meet them where they're at. And I think that this testing site has really done that in a good way here in the city, that we've, strengthened our kinship. We've strengthened our familial connections by doing this work, and that we've showed our community that, we are leaders in this pandemic. We're not just gonna sit back and wait for the government to like do everything for us and take care of us, because sometimes it's not the best. We want the best for our community, so we've taken it into our hands. And I feel like all of the leadership at the site has done such a great job of leading this, and I'm just so grateful to be part of the team and helping people in my community.
Key themes are around visiting and movement, right? So we visit, and movement's not a bad thing, but it's not sterile, it's alive, it's vibrant. It's based on our relationships, we're trusting each other, we do ceremony with those vaccines. So that's the vision I have, and those are the public health systems that we always had as First Nations, Inuit and Métis people. The vision for the future and the vision that I had in mind when I started working on the Auduzhe Clinic is around generative health and public health systems. So by generative, we mean attachment through the ages where all people and things are connected. What if we had a public health service or a health service where actually when people left, their relationships with themselves, with each other, with the natural world were strengthened, so that Wekotowin is strengthened.
They need to see conversations like this happening. I think they need to see themselves reflected in medical spaces and places. And I think they need to see themselves reflected in the research. and the way information is gathered about our people, not in a way that it has in the past.
There's a lot of ingredients, I think, to help our Indigenous community live up to their fullest potential and have healthy and vibrant families. So some of the things I think we need in play is it's just common things. You know, we need to move things up in the various categories and social determinants of health. So I think my role here at NAMIRES is help people that are homeless to deal with whatever issues that there are that they have to deal with. If you think of it in a circle, at the center of the circle is a small ring, and that's ourself. So in order to create a healthy community, you have to make yourself healthy first. And then if you can, at that core of yourself, be healthy, maybe you can affect your family to be healthy. And then if you have a family that's very healthy and vibrant and doing well, maybe if you can encourage other people in the community to do that and create a healthy community. And then if that community can be healthy and so on, then maybe the nation can be healthy. So if you look at it from that Indigenous lens, it starts with ourselves. And sometimes it's not easy to heal ourselves, and we don't need to do it alone. There's lots of places that will help. That's a small start. There's a heck of a lot of work, and sometimes it can feel like moving mountains, but we can move mountains. And we have lots of wise and educated people. We have beautiful cultural teachings that can help guide our way. So we can get through this. We just need people to have a similar vision, I think, and build off each other and support each other in trying to create healthy communities and healthy nations.